أنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد إخوتي في الله، فاعلموا أن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. As you were aware of it, the title of this talk بإذنه سبحانه وتعالى is an compromise honor. Uncompromise honor. And I know in your minds, or at least some of you, are thinking about certain things, about honor itself, about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His deen, about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba, about the Salaf al-Salih. And all of you who have that thought or these ideas, I will say, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you. These individuals or these lists, the list that I mentioned, are deserved to be talked about. But the uncompromised honor that I'm talking about, it is not any of the things that I listed. It is not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. It's not Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Though everything that I will say, probably most of them came from those two sources, بإذنه سبحانه وتعالى. But the uncompromised honor that I'm talking about is our sisters, is women. A lot of you think, subhanAllah, what are we talking about? Are we not going to discuss about Khalid bin Walid radiyallahu anhu and what he did for the Ummah? Are we not going to talk about Hamza bin Abdul Muttalib radiyallahu anhu and how he gave his life for Islam and his deen? Are we not going to talk about Mus'ab bin Umair radiyallahu anhu, the first man that Rasulullah chose to deliver this deen from the city of Mecca to the people of Ansar in the city of Medina? Ikhwati fi Allah, the true honor, and that we cannot compromise, the honor that we cannot allow to be scratched, we cannot allow anyone to talk about, we cannot allow anybody to tamper with, we cannot allow anyone to change their views, is women, our sisters in Islam. Because without them, none of us would be here. Without them, none of the ulama that you know, great men that we talk about, Ibn Taymiyyah, who is he? But the product of his mother. Ahmad bin Hanbal, who is he? But the product of his mother. Bin Baz rahimahullah, who is he? But the product of his mother. So in reality, the honor that we all must maintain is our women بإذنه سبحانه وتعالى. And the reason that I chose this, يا إخوتي في الله, is because Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, as all of you are aware of, he said, the first ابتلاء, the first fitna of Bani Israel was in their women. The first test, one thing that Bani Israel could not handle was their women. And when the women of Bani Israel became corrupted, then their religion and their men also became corrupted. And the day that the Sahaba or the Salaf rahimahumullah were able to maintain their women, teach them, honor them, respect them, treat them well, that was the day that the Muslim were respected and Islam were respected. Muslims were respected and Islam were respected. But the day that we say, La, we should not allow women to come out of their houses. No. Boys, don't do anything. Let your sisters clean the house. And you sit, inshallah, and enjoy because you are the man of the house in the future, inshallah. And that little banana breath who's sitting right there, useless kid, we let them enjoy and be the empire of the house. Well, the little girls who are the true future of the ummah, been oppressed and abused. And I'm not talking about every single case, I'm talking about general statement. I'm making general statement. So ya ikhwati fillah, until we understand the status of the women in Islam, until we understand they are the true power by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, until we respect them and give them the respect that they deserve, none of our condition or most of our condition would not change. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was talking about the believers, what did He say? Ya ayyuhan nasu inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha. Ya ayyuhan nasu ibudu rabbukum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahida wa khalaqa minha zawjaha wa batha minhuma rijalan kathiran wa nisaa. We all came from the same seed, male and female. Both of us. Allah did not say for the men only say إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ, but He said men and women, both of you say إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ. In the end of Surah Ali Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala قَالَ فَاسْتَجَابَ لَهُمْ رَبُّهُمْ أَنِّي لَا أُضِيعُ عَمَلَ عَامِلٍ مِّنْكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى. مِنْ ذَكَر, male or female, both of them, male and female, not only male but both of them. ويقول الله في سورة الأحزاب إن المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات, and He lists both of male and female, ذاكرين الذاكرات الحافظين والحافظات, so on so on, and all of, because we are equally إخوتي في الله in the sight of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. يا إخوتي في الله, why do we have to respect them? And why? That Brother Saeed have to talk about this subject that a lot of you think it is unimportant. We all know what sisters are supposed to be doing. They're supposed to be cooking and changing diapers. Am I right, brothers? You know, they're supposed to be cleaning the house. They're supposed to be a good wives and good mothers. They're supposed to be obeying their husbands. They're supposed to be entertaining, and the man has a need that he should be she should entertain that. But this is not the purpose of women only, ya ikhwati fillah. This is what we like to magnify. This is what we like to talk about, because we men, and most of the time, where men are sitting on front behind the microphone, men are giving khutbah, men are giving lectures, so we only most of the time show our side. Ya Allah, we always said, يقول صلى الله عليه وسلم to the women of the Sahaba, look at your position, how is your husband with you? فَإِنَّهُ جَنَّتَكِ أَوْ نَارِكِ, is your Jannah or is your Jahannam? We like to quote a hadith that protects our rights. But a lot of times, we overlook the rights of the sisters, and they are the true honor that we all should maintain, ya إخوتي في الله. إخوتي في الله. The reason that I'm talking about this is the day that these sisters who don't understand their role and their importance, then it will become fitna for us and for them. And our children at home, who do they learn from, ya ikhwati fillah? They don't learn from the father most of the time. They don't learn from the sibling most of the time. They learn from the mothers, ya ikhwati fillah. And if the mothers are not righteous, then subhanallah, most of the time the upcoming generation, most of the time the future of the ummah is in danger. Illa ma rahima rabbuk. Look at the sister side, go and see the sister side. And see the number of the sisters compared to the number of the brothers. See how many of them are taking notes. See how many of them wearing niqab. And compare the brothers who are wearing have beards to the sister wearing niqab. And compare to the brothers who are taking notes to the brothers to the sister who are taking notes. And compare to the sisters who came to the brothers who came here. You would see, mashallah, the majority of the khayr is there on their side. But at the same time, الرجال قوامون على النساء. Men are maintainers of women. And subhanallah, yes, it was, that's true. Men supposed to be the protectors and the maintainers of women. Lakin subhanallah, nowadays, تغيرت الأحوال وانقلبت الموازين. So men are maintained by women most of the time. And if your wife, if he doesn't bother you about Salat al-Fajr, most of the men would not come to Salat al-Fajr. If our wives are not bothering us about taking children to the masjid, most of us would not bring our children to the masjid. And just come and stand outside of the masjid on Saturdays and Sundays. And see how many mothers are dropping off their children. And subhanallah, you sometimes, I wonder, I think all of these children, I can? They have no fathers? They all yateens? What happened to their fathers? Alhamdulillah, he's sitting in Tim Hortons, talking about the election. Oh, he's gonna win. No. No, you know, Mrs. Clinton was, subhanallah. What happened to your child? Did he go to Salat al-Fajr? Did he memorize Surah al-Mulk? That Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said a surah in the book of Allah that protected sahibaha min adab al-qabr, from the punishment of the grave. Do you care about that? Most of us know, subhanallah. But we know the ayah, الرجال قوامون على النساء. We memorize that ayah. فسبحانك رب رب العزة عما يصفون والله يا إخوتي في الله انقلبت الموازين. Things have been changed. The mothers are more concerned about the brothers, about the children more than the fathers. And listen to the معاملة of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم about women and what he used to say صلى الله عليه وسلم. He used to say to the men, Allah, 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 Allah fi nisa, fa innahunna awan indakun. This is when the men were men. When the men, when al-rijal fi'lan qawwamuna ala nisa. If you think you are men, how many of you have second wife or two wives or three wives? It used to be that the men would marry women, now women marry men. And it became other way around because she is the qawama. But here, Rasulullah at that time, he used to say, Allah, Allah, fi nisa, fa innahunna awanun indakun. Innahunna asirat. They are under, you have mercy on them. Yani you're mad, I know you're mad. You're responsible when you do your responsibility. But be careful the way that you treat your wife. Be careful the way that you treat your daughter. Be careful the way that you treat the women who are under you. Allah, Allah, fi nisa. And now I will say, Allah, Allah, fi nisa, ya ikhwati fi Allah. And give them their rights. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow you to do this. Wa yaqulu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, khayrukum khayrukum li ahli, wa ana khayrukum li ahli. He said, the best of you are those who are best to their wives. And I am the best to his wives. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ya ikhwati fillah, never discriminate daughters from the boys. Never said, Abdullah, Al-Tayyib, Al-Qasim, Ibrahim, you have special treatment. But the girls, Fatima, Ruqayya, Umm Kulthum, Zainab, you're a second class citizen. Never told that sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to his children. He used to treat them equally. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every time almost that Fatima comes, he will get up sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he will welcome his daughter and he will kiss her forehead and he will say, sit right here next to me. Sit right here next to me. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa radiyallahu anha. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he knew his society, his community. That the community of Jahl, community who had no respect for women, so he gave them reward, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, I'll tell you the reward if you treat your daughters well. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whosoever have two daughters and raise them well based on the book of Allah and the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, qal, fahuma, he is my companion in Jannah. Fahuwa rafiqi fil Jannah. Imagine, all you have to do, lose this little kid and take him to the zoo and leave him with the monkeys. You know, you have to. If he's not listening, he's not obeying, he's not respecting his parents, you know, don't say he's my son. He's going to carry my name, the family name. Look at the daughters. Look at them, subhanAllah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he did not talk about the boys, but he said about the girls. He said, if you have two of them, and you raise them well, you, Ya Abdullah, my companions in Jannah. You, Ya Abdullah, will be the neighbor of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah. And subhanAllah, Allahu Akbar, when you are the neighbor of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أعمل دار البقاء رضوان خازنها الجار أحمد والرحمن ناشيها أرض لها ذهب والمسك طيرتها والزعفران حشيش نابت فيها أنهارها لبن من محض أنهارها لبن من عسل حتى قال والطير في على الأسقان على والطير على الأسقان عاكفة تسبح الله جهرا في مغانيها يعني جنة of عرضها سماوات والأرض. All this is if Allah blesses you with two daughters and you maintain them, teach them the book of Allah, put that little hijab on them, and you say, Aisha, you look beautiful with that hijab. Taymiyyah, you look wonderful with that hijab. You know, and subhanAllah, a lot of sisters and a lot of brothers, they don't understand that children from young age, they adopt what they see, and they go with what you teach them. And the sisters, mashallah, they say, oh, she's so cute. She's just going to a wedding. She's only 9 years old, mashallah. Put a miniskirt for her. And miniskirt, when she bends down, you can see, subhanAllah, the moon from the other end. Wallahu Akbar. But this is not Islam. Aisha radiyallahu anha, she was married at the age of 9. You know, if you think that's abuse, oh, Oprah, this lady, she was pregnant when she was 9 years old. So she is an adult. Don't treat them as a kid. No. You say, aib. Shame on you. This is not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala desires from you. This is not what Allah wants from you. This is what Rasulullah, this is not what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants from you. And let us go, ya ikhwati fillah. Take examples from the women of the past, from the salihat. We always talk about Ibn Taymiyyah rahimah, and he is deserved to be talked about. We always talk about Ibn Qayyim al-Jawzi rahimahullah, and he is an imam we should talk about. We always talk about Ibn Daqiq al-Eid, and he is an imam and we should respect him. We always mention about Abdullah ibn Mubarak, and he is an imam from the A'immat al-Ummah. But today we will talk about the salihat from the women of the past. The first of this, ya ikhwati fillah, is Sarah bint Haran. Sarah bint Haran. And who is Sarah? Is the wife of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Sarah radiyallahu anha wa alayhi salam, aydan, she was so beautiful. And she was not fooled by her beauty. She did not say, oh, I'm so beautiful, I'll let me be a model. Oh, mashallah, I'll be, mashallah, doing tawaf in the malls. I'll be going from one mall to another mall. And mashallah, from Scarborough Town Center to the, what do you call it, Dan Mills, I'll be doing that stuff for a matter between two malls. And every day I have to go and buy new cell phones and have a new makeup. No, Allah. She was one of the most beautiful women ever. ولكن كانت عابدة قانتة لله سبحانه وتعالى، قانتة مؤمنة. And look, when the king took her as one of his slave girls, and the king at that time had a habit that every beautiful woman that he had, his boys would go around, and they would say, "Oh, we follow a beautiful woman," and he would say, "Well, bring her." And Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam had no authority, no power to protect his wife other than be linked to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he put his trust in Allah, and then she was in the palace of that tyrant. And what did she do? Wallahi, ya ikhwati fillah, our sisters need to know the salaf of the salihah. They need to know the biography of these individuals. At the time of hardship, the sister should not run to her mother. She should not call her parents. She should not say, "I need authority to protect me." But she should go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When this man came to approach her, wants to commit a zina with her, وَهِيَ طَاهِرَةٌ عَفَانٌ, what did she do? She asked Allah to protect him, to protect her from him. And every time he tried to come approach her, some of the ulama of Mu'arrikhin, they said, rahimahumullah, he would not be able to move. And then he would say, this must be you. Ask whoever you ask and release me from this. And then she said, "Ya Allah, let him go." And then that person was unintelligent, tried it 3 times. And then he said, "Innama ji'tumuni bi shaytana ukhrujuha anni," you brought me a shaytan, a devil. But, and he is the devil in reality. Take her out of the palace. He is the devil. And not only that, and he said, and take a servant with you. Take Hajar with you. And look what Hajar. Servant, but mu'mina. And you don't have to be from a noble family to do righteous deeds. You don't have to know your lineage. And you say, "Well, I'm from this tribe. Or my fathers go back to Hassan bin Ali radiyallahu anhu. Or my father or my family goes back to Al-Hussein." And subhanAllah, almost every Pakistani, every Yemeni, every Somali, we all go back to whom? Al-Hassan wal-Hussein. Yani al-alam al-Islami kullu are the offspring of Hassan al-Hussein. Nobody left any other children? None? Ma yakhtaq Allah ya ikhwati fillah. And you see, mashaAllah, this brother from Africa. And he tells you, "I am the offspring of Al-Hussein." And he says, subhanAllah, Hussein, he looked like this. Ya khay, call Bilal, claim Bilal radiyallahu anhu, we will give that to you. And Hussein that. And you see this Pakistani say, "Ana Sayyid." I go back to, "Ana Sayyid." Fi Allah dum garan nahi kharaab hai, Rashwai, what is this? Allahu a'lam, is this not true? Ya ikhwati fillah. This is the case of a mu'min. Let us come back to this Hajar, who was servant of Allah. Amma. And then Sarah radiyallahu anha. She was not able to give birth to children. So she said to Ibrahim, "Ya Ibrahim, don't die like this. Marry her. Be with her. And have children from her. Allah will bless you. Child from her." يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى قال إني مهاجر إلى ربي سيهدين. And we made hijjah for the sake. قال فبشرناه بغلام حليم فلما بلغ معه السعي, أي غلام حليم, very patient, forbearing child. And that is إسماعيل. On the case of يعقوب in إسحاق, يقول فبشرناه بغلام عليم, because إسحاق, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the sifat al-ilm, that he was a alim. But for the case of Ismail, Allah qal bi-ghulamin halim, a patient child. So Hajar got pregnant. And then Sarah, of course, radiyallahu anha, she got jealous. She's more beautiful, yes. She's free lady, yes. She was the first wife of Ibrahim, yes. But she got jealous of Hajar because now Ibrahim is going to be a father. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered Ibrahim to take his offspring to the place of Makkah, in the city of Makkah. Now look at this, ya ikhwati fillah, also. When Hajar radiyallahu anha, and Jibreel and Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he brought them to the place of city of Makkah, to the Bayt al-Haram, the ulama rahimahumullah al-mu'arrikhin said he did not inform her anything. He just gave her what she needed for that time and he turned away. فَقَالَتْ يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ إِلَى مَنْ تَتْرُكَنَا يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ Who's going to take care of us? And Ibrahim alayhi salam would not look, turn to her or talk to her. And then she's walking behind him and she said, يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ إِلَى مَنْ تَتْرُكَنَا إِلَى مَنْ نَلْجَعْ إِلَى مَنْ نَعْوَى إِلَيْ And Ibrahim is not talking to her. حتى قالت الله أمرك بهذا Did Allah order you to do this? قال نعم In the narration you turn and he just not and قالت and then she said اذهب فإن الله لن يضيعنا فإن الله لن يضيعنا She said go Allah will not waste us But look subhanAllah إِلَّا مَا رَحِمَ رَبُّكَ And I'm not talking about the sisters, mashallah, who fear Allah, who is wearing niqab and hijab and jilbab. But I'm talking about the sisters who have some wrong impression about the purpose of their existence. If the husband says, listen, we have nowhere to go. We cannot go back home. Or we cannot both go back home. One of us has to stay and work for the family. You stay with the children and raise the children in a Muslim country. What would the sister say? Oh, you want to get rid of me so you can get married to another wife. Right? SubhanAllah. But Hajar, she said, go, Allah will not waste us. Go, Allah will not waste us. And then she stayed there, radiyallahu anha, until Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam built the Kaaba. In a very well-known story. The other story, ya ikhwati fillah, is the story of Hanna bint Oh, the wife of Ali Imran, and this is the wife, the mother of Maryam. Look at this woman. Her aim, her goal in this life, was for her to have a child who will serve the house of Allah. قال ربي إني نذرت لك ما في بطني محر فتقبل. Ya Allah. إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ مَا فِي بَطْنِي مُحَرِّ يَا اللَّهُ Whatever I'm carrying is yours. I want that to be your servant. The servant of your house. And when she gave birth to a child, قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي وَضَعْتُ أُنْثَى وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا وَضَعَتْ وَلَيْسَ الذَّكَرُ كَالْأُنْثَى يعني look, يقول العلماء when Allah said وَلَيْسَ الذَّكَرُ كَالْأُنْثَى Male are not equal to female. It means women. How women, some of them hold higher status than men. وَلَيْسَ الذَّكَرُ كَالْأُنْثَى يعني how what do you know about women? Maybe you think women, they don't know much, they can't do much, but Allah says, لَيْسَ الذَّكَرُ كَالْأُنْثَى Which means a man can never do what a woman can do. Can you give a birth? You're like, oh, Bismillah, carry from here. Ya inshallah, take it out. You can never do this. You can never take 1 second being in contraction or being in labor. You can't because this is not you, ya ikhwati fillah, or not us. And this is what she asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is for her to raise her child. And even when Allah gave her a child, with a female child, she made that child a servant of Masjid Baytullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, the other woman that we should mention, ya ikhwati fillah, in the history of Islam is Khadija bint Khuwaylid. Khadija bint Khuwaylid radiyallahu anha. A woman who accepted Islam first. Or is the first woman who ever accepted Islam. Nobody ever, as we know, ya ikhwati fillah, said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah before Khadija radiyallahu anha. In the history of Islam, the first person to say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, I bear witness there is no God worthy of worship, but Allah was Khadija. Was Khadija bint Khuwaylid. Not a brother, not a cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but his wife. And the first person who died for the sake of Allah was also a female. And then the brother, mashallah, I'm a man. Yes, you are a man, a useless man, mashallah. You know, yes, that is the case. If the person don't fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and if the person doesn't do what Allah and His Messenger ordered him to do, he's a useless individual. And Khadija radiyallahu anha, she gave everything in her power to serve Islam and to serve Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Never ever said, Ya Rasulullah, you're always outside. Come on, give it up. Give time for your family. Spend some quality time with the wife and the children. Take us to the park. You know, we haven't seen some monkeys and donkeys out there for a while. MashaAllah. No. Her husband would come back, Rasulullah alayhi wa sallam, and he kullahu asa wa ta'ab. They rejected him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They spat on his face. They put filth on his head where he was in the state of sujood. Some of them beat him up sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or tried to beat him up. All this, and he comes back and he finds comfort and ease in his house. It's not like some of the women, when the man is coming, mashallah, he has to get ready for jihad fi sabilillah. So I'm going home. Allahumma ya Rabb, hawalina wala alayna. Ya Allah, protect us and not on us. You know, he stands at the door, wallahi. He's speaking, Ya Allah, Ya Allah. I hope she's asleep, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, Ya Allah, Ya Allah. La ya ikhwati fillah. Khadija was different. Khadija, she knew when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is coming home, she's ready for him. She's ready to comfort him. She's ready to say, La wallahi, la yuhzika Allahu abada. Don't worry, Ya Muhammad. Allah will never disgrace you. Who are you? Don't you know who you are? You know? Don't you know who you are? You, Ya Muhammad. Wallahi, you never tell a lie. Wallahi, you go to your family members. You give a sadaqah. You help those who are in need. وَتُعِينُ عَلَى النَّوَائِبِ الْحَقِّ. Allah will never disgrace you. She comforts him. She does the job of a mu'mina. And this is the women that we need. This is the honor that we're all searching for. This is what we cannot compromise. This is the thing that people say, oh, today we're looking for Khalifa. Khalifa what? Who is he going to rule? All these models? All these sisters, mashallah, when they come to Salat al-Eid, they think, mashallah, they have to come to Arath al-Aziyah, or model show, or what do they call nowadays? Fitness show? Allahu A'lam. No. If we need Khalifa, who is he going to rule? You and I? When he says, you cannot shave your beard, Allahu Akbar. We need our freedom. Let us make hijrah to Israel. Let us make hijrah to America. The Khalifa cannot rule us nowadays because we are not ready. We are not. When our wives, our daughters, our mothers are ready and they teach us that we should be ready, then the Khalifa, when he comes, then he will find people who will follow his orders. Us, we will say, no, we don't want this. We want to sell cigarettes. We want to have this. We want our children to have this and that. La wallahi. So ya ikhwati fillah, this is the wife that we're all looking for bi idnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Umm Sulaym. Wama adraka ma Umm Sulaym. What do you know about Umm Sulaym? Abu Talha comes. Abu Talha, a man that the women of Medina were fighting for him. I mean, they would fight for this man, Abu Talha. But Abu Talha, he only wants Umm Sulaym. And Umm Sulaym is the wife, is the mother of Anas bin Malik radiyallahu anhuma. He doesn't want any other woman, he wants Umm Sulaym. She's a noble lady, she's a smart, she's intelligent, she's beautiful, she has wealth, she's everything. He wants Umm Sulaym. So he comes and he says, Ya Umm Sulaym, I'm here. فَقَالَتْ يَا أَبَا طَلْحَ مِثْلُكَ لَا يُرَدْ. Person like you can never be rejected. وَلَكِنْ I am a Muslim and you are najis, kafirun najis. We cannot be together. فَقَالَ لَا وَاللَّهِ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا الْأَحْمَرُ وَالْأَبْيَضُ. He said, no, wallahi, the reason that you're refusing it is because you want an ahmar gold, wal abyad silver. قالت لا والله. If you say لا إله إلا الله, that is my mahr. If you say لا إله إلا الله, that is my mahr. So فقال أبا طلحة, that's it. All I have to say لا إله إلا الله. Yes, لا إله إلا الله. Let us go. Where's Brother Sa'id and two witnesses? Let's go. لا. But he became a Sahabi رضي الله عنه. Sahabi. He, yes, entered Islam because he won that lady. But he became the people of Ahl al-Jannah bi-idhnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. But look at Ummah Sulaym. Look, Ummah Sulaym, this man, he won a woman that is smart, not a woman that is beautiful. Now the brothers, mashallah, all of you, you know how everybody goes to the imam's office. I'm looking for a wife. Mashallah. Brother, you're looking for a righteous wife? Yes, I'm looking for a wife. You know, and you think the brother, mashallah, his eyes will pop out and say, mashallah. Brother, make sure that we don't have your janazah before your wedding night. So relax. No heart attack. And then he said, what do you want? Oh, she has to be beautiful. She has to be skinny. She has to be tall or short. She has to be this and this. And mashallah, oh yeah, she has to have hijab. قاتلك الله يا عدو الله. That's all you care about, hijab, beauty and the color and the status and everything. But this man, he married women who and has and who have understanding. First thing she did, she said, I cannot be with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm not a man. He's a man. I cannot sit with him and say, tell me ya Rasulullah, give me the description of Jannah. Tell me, Ya Rasulullah, when I die, how big is my palace? Ya Rasulullah, give me a hug. She cannot do this. So what did she do? She sent her son who's 10 years old. She said, I want to know about this deen. I want to learn. There's no DVDs, there's no internet, there's no CDs, there's not. I want to learn. So what did she did? She sent her little microphone to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She said, Ya Anas, go and sit in front of Rasulullah and record and remember everything that he says and he does and come back and tell me. So she said, she dressed him radiallahu anhu and she said, Ya Rasulullah, this is my son Anas, he's your servant. He is your servant. Ya Rasulullah, make dua for him. فَقَالَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ Oh Allah, give him a long life. Oh Allah, give him a wealth. Oh Allah, give him offspring that are righteous. Subhanallah. And Allah gave him everything that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for. Everything. But look what also she did for her husband. They had a child who was sick. And then one day he went to the masjid, radiyallahu anhu. And when he went to the masjid, he came back. And qala, kayfa wajadta walad? How is my son? قالت أسكن ما يكون. He's very calm. Very calm. And what did she do, يا إخوتي في الله? In his absence, the boy died. The boy died. So she prepared the child, she buried the child, and she waited for her husband. She dressed nice. She fed, mashallah, prepared dinner for him. And he came from this. How is the son? Oh, my child. He is in a good condition. He's very calm. He's not complaining about anything. And then she fed him radiallahu anhu. And sisters, a secret that I will tell you, but don't tell their brothers. If you want your husband to listen, to talk to you, feed him first. That is how we work. That's how they work. That's how we all work. If you feed him, mashallah, you know, he's all ears, elephant ears. If you don't feed him, things are not stable. Inshallah. Now, she fed him, and he, mashallah, she's ready for her husband. And he spent the time with her. And then she said, Ya Aba Talha, if a neighbor gives me something, if I borrow something from the neighbor, and then they ask that thing back, should I be upset about it? He said, what would you be upset about it? This is their belongings, and they ask back. She said, well, Allah took his ariya back. Allah took his gift back. So he gets very upset. He said, my son died. and you fed me, and you slept with me at the same time, and I am in the situation, even instead of giving condolences, you just, what you did? And he got upset. And he went to Rasulullah in the month, said, Ya Rasulullah, أَعَلِمْتَ مَا صَنَعَتْ أُمَّ السُّلَيْمِ. Do you know what Umm al-Sulaym did? Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, she, that night that you spent, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed seed in her womb and you will have a righteous child. From that night, and that child, if you go back to the Mu'arrikheen, he became Hafid al-Qur'an al-Kitab, Hafid al-Kitabillah. And he became one of the ulama and one of the mujahideen fi sabilillah. Wallahu a'lam, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The other example, ya ikhwati fillah, is the example of Khansa. And this is a woman who had four sons. All of them, they went into the battle of Qadisiyah. All of them. And when they went to the battle of Qadisiyah, ikhwati fillah, when they went there, before the battle, she said, come. Come, all of four. And she said, Wallahi, I never ever cheated your father. I never disrespect myself. All of you are from one father. Today is the day that you should honor me and honor your father and die and fight for the sake, for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all four, ya ikhwati fillah, all of them fought and all of them were killed. All four. What did she say? قالت الحمد لله الذي أقر عيني بشهادتهم في سبيل الله. الحمد لله who blessed me with their shahada. الحمد لله who blessed me with their shahada. All of them are shuhada في سبيل الله. A mother was four shuhada. And a shaheed is a person who will intercede for his family members. And imagine, you are the shaheed and your mother is the first on the list, and this woman rahimahullah radiyallahu anha wa rahimaha, she achieved the highest status of the salihin bi idnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. The brothers jazakum Allah khair, so we have to start for salat al-maghrib, and inshallah we will continue with the subject some other time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you all. Subhanahu subhanahu wa ta'ala bi'izzati تبارك الذي نزل الفرقان على عبده ليكون للعالمين نذيرا وتبارك الذي جعل في السماء بروجا وجعل فيها سراجا وقمرا منيرا وهو الذي جعل الليل والنهار خلفة لمن أراد أن يذكر وأراد شكورا وعباد الرحمن الذين يمشون على الأرض هونا وإذا خاطبهم الجاهلون قالوا سلاما والصلاة والسلام على المعلم الجليل المؤيد بجبريل المذكور في التوراة والإنجيل نشهد أنه بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين فصلوات الله وسلامه عليه ما تطوع مسك وفاح وما ترنم حمام وصح وما هذل غرق وناح أما بعد إخوتي في الله فاعلم أن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار ثم أما بعد. We all tired, as we can all see. I personally would like to sleep right here. Driving home, it seems that going to taking a long journey to the city of Mecca. But alhamdulillah ثم alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala كان أمره مفعولا. So therefore we have to finish the amr, or what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had decreed for us for the night. Since last talk that we had about the sisters and some of the brothers got jealous and they said, Brother Saeed, what about us? So alhamdulillah, I decided to continue talking about sisters. So we will continue talking about the subject inshallah. لَعَلَّ اللَّهَ يُحْدِثُ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ أَمْرًا. Now, if we talk about, continue with the same subject, I'm not going to talk about awakening the giant, but we'll talk about uncompromising honor. So, or uncompromised honor bi-idnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we will talk about a few points that the sisters also need to know And I don't want them to think, Alhamdulillah, the Brother Saeed mentioned a lot of things that the brothers should do for the sisters and the status of the sisters, and therefore there is no responsibility towards the sisters. At the same time, I don't want them to live with no instruction or directions. There are a few things that they need to do bi-idnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there's still things that we need to do for them. First of the things that as Muslims we need to understand, especially as men, we need to understand there is no need for Muslims to fight for their rights. If they were Christian or they were any other religion, I will say fight for your right. But alhamdulillah, Islam gave women their rights 1400 years ago. Therefore, there is no need for them to have Muslim women movement or Muslim women rights organizations or Muslim women abuse shelters or something. None of that is acceptable in Islam, because alhamdulillah, thumma alhamdulillah, Allah has gave them the right that they deserve. But the sisters also have to understand that they themselves were fooled. They were fooled by the kuffar. What did the kuffar tell them? They told them, if you become like us, then you will achieve success like us. And what the sisters don't understand is, look what happened to the other religions. Look to the Christianity. The day that they say, we drop the Bible and we do not need the Bible, we don't want to practice the Bible, what happened? They reached the moon. They became civilized people. They study, they learn, they develop, they improve, they revive everything. But look what happened to the Muslim the day that we said we don't want the Quran. Where are we? What happened to us? We went to zero, went to square one. Why? Because the Bible was the thing that's holding them down as humans. If you're a scientist and you say the earth is this or that, they will say, no, he's a devil, kill him. Where in Islam, in the Quran, the first ayah was Iqra, learn, read, understand, write. You know, that's the difference. So the day that they say, we don't want this Bible, we don't want the church, let us separate the church from the state. So we have church and we have state, they say they prosper. They learn, they're human. They develop. But the day the Muslim said, we don't want the Quran, وَقَالَ الرَّسُولَ إِيَا رَبِّ النَّقَوْمِ اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا, the day that we made hijrah from the book of Allah, what happened? We became followers of those individuals. We became a people who follow other nations. And this is what the sisters also need to understand. These kuffar, they said, listen, if you follow us, your women will become like our women. Do we want that? The answer is no. يعني معوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. But no, this is the microphones of Ahl Sunnah. Now, what happens here is can someone fix the microphone, ya ikhwa? Maybe if we use that one, would be a lot better. Just this one. Give me this one. Is it working? The sister, brothers can hear the sisters talking from here. So sisters, please, if you can stop or refrain from talking, then everybody can benefit, inshallah. If you don't want to listen, then inshallah, take your kids, take your husband if he's here, and go home. But if you want to listen, if you want to listen, please sit down and let us all, inshallah, finish whatever time that is left for the night, inshallah. As I was saying, ikhwati fillah, this non-Muslim or this Western society in general, or non-Muslim society, they try to brainwash our sisters. And you see, unfortunately, sisters, instead of carrying the Mus'haf of Kitabullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, instead of carrying 40 hadith to memorize, instead of reviewing what they already memorized from the Quran, you see them reading this crazy magazine, talking about, oh, how to please your husband, 100 ways to please your husband. And the one who wrote that has no husband. Yani subhanallah. The one who wrote that herself has no husband. Yani faqid al-shay la yu'ti. Yani if he doesn't have, if you don't have, you can't give. And the Muslims say, oh look, you know, you do this with your eyebrows, you do this, you change the color of your hair, you can please your husband. No, ya ikhwati fillah. Atyab al-tib. Atyab al-tib. The most beautiful thing is wudu. Yani subhanallah. You don't need any of these things. All you need is wudu. Yani Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أو أبو هريرة يقول من أراد أن يطيل غرته فأمن فليفعل. All you need is wudu. So the sisters, my nasiha to them is, if you really want to be like Khadija bint Khuwaylid, if you want to be like Umm Sulaym, if you want to be like Aisha, if you want to be like the mother of Ahmed bin Hanbal, then drop this nonsense magazines and pick up the Quran and read the Sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and learn who you are. I mean, we were supposed to be talking about awakening a giant. Let's talk about the giant that is asleep. Well, they are one of those giants are asleep. They don't understand what they are. You know, subhanallah, if Allah has given you all that and you were fooled by nonsense, then you really, you don't understand your status and your position in this deen. Now, also, ya ikhwati fillah, if you see how this Western society, how do they use or abuse women? They abuse them in everything. You know, they want to do advertise for a tire. You see a woman that is almost undressed. Yeah, it's not like you're going to bring four women and put them in your vehicle and bismillah. No. You need tires. What she has to do, what she's doing there is because this is how this society works. You know, they see, they tell you in psychology, they taught us this, that if you want to convince someone to buy something that he doesn't need, what do? You aggravate his sexual urge or need. So you don't need tires, but you see this person that's beautiful woman next to the tires and you sold. You may even never even have a vehicle, but you have four tires. You don't have a car, but you have four tires. It's because this is how they want to, you know, manipulate people. But a mu'mina, subhanallah, when she goes, when she's going out, she understands that she is a hamil risala, and a person with on a mission. Not anybody who just want to go out and in and out. No, someone. On a mission, walillahi alhamd. The other thing that the sisters really go through sometimes, and we brothers are responsible, we put cap on the sisters. And I know, for a fact, I don't need ayat and hadith to prove this, but sometimes we hinder sisters. And the proof is, you see the sister side before marriage, they volunteer, mashallah, they learn, they in the classes, in halaqat, they read, they came to halaqat al-Qur'an, they memorize the book of Allah. As soon as she gets married, khalas. She says, qabiltu from this end, and she says, I divorce Islam from the other end. And this is something that is not right, ya ikhwati fillah. So we are brothers doing something wrong. Why as soon as we marry these sisters, they're not developing, they're not continuing with the education, Islamic education? Why are they just being, alhamdulillah, I have a husband now, I have two kids, three kids, four kids, khalas. La. We need the sisters to continue learning their deen. And husbands, brothers, let us fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and let us not discourage the sister to drop Islam and be housewife. Yes, I'm not saying, please don't get me wrong. I'm not saying the sister, she should be mashallah, tawafa, in every masjid, in every house, except her house. We're not saying this. We're saying no. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made everything balanced in Islam. So time for halaqah, time for personal development, time for her husband, time for the children, time for the house. There are a lot of responsibility, so the brothers also should make this responsibility easy for the sister. So for the sisters, like when they accepting proposal, they should number one see the deen of that individual. You know, the deen of the brother, mashallah. Not how nice is his vehicle, what kind of vehicle is he driving, you know, mashallah. I always say to the brothers, always, you know, look at the brothers, mashallah. Have you ever seen, it's not in the masajid, but when we have event outside, like schools, university, and the brothers, what do you guys do, brothers? What do you do? You put the four windows down, you jump Sa'd al-Ghamidi, and you come on your drive, and you make your little tawaf on the school. And the sisters, they're like, oh, look at that car. And the car is from Enterprise, it's a rental vehicle. But the sisters doesn't know that. You know, but the brothers like, she said, oh my God, he's so cute. He has no teeth, mashallah. He's not, but he's cute. And it's not the person that is cute, it's the car that is cute. You know, sisters, they should look for someone with deen. Alhamdulillah. Yani, when Asma bint Umayyah came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she said, Ya Rasulullah, three individuals came to propose to me. Abu Jahl, Muawiyah, you know, and what should I do? So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no. Abu Jahl, darraba lil nisa. He said, no, Abu Jahl, it's women. So stay away from that. He is a very harsh person, very difficult person. He's not good with women. So drop him. Muawiyah, Sa'luk is poor. Why don't you marry Usama? Usama, who used to be a slave, his father was a slave, his mother was a slave, but he's a hibb Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah loved him so much. And she married Usama, and from that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed her with ni'mah. Likewise, when a lady came to Umar bin al-Khattab in the middle of the night, she said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, he was the Amir, I need your advice. He said, about what? She said, Az-Zubair bin Awam proposed to me. Az-Zubair bin Awam radiyallahu anhu proposed to me. قَالَ أَنْعَمْ بِهِ رَجُلًا. Wow. Zubair bin Awam, wow. What a wonderful man. عَشَرَ مُبَشِّرٍ بِالْجَنَّةِ. حواري رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the son of Safiya bint Abd al-Muttalib رضي الله عنه. يعني, but he said no, but he beats women. No, so don't marry him. الزبير, من منا مثل الزبير, والله his shoes are better than all of us, الله أعلم. يعني الزبير شعر في جسد الزبير خير من ذا سعيد and 10,000 like Brother Sa'id. But قال Abu Umar bin Khattab, no, don't marry him. He's not gentle with women. MashaAllah, in the middle of the night turns to Mike Tyson, boom. You know, stay away from him. You know. So she didn't, radiallahu anha. She did not marry him. So a brother, when you marry a sister, fear Allah concerning her and treat her well. The other thing, ya ikhwati fillah, is a lot of sisters, again, they become too busy with their affairs. And the husbands also say, well, we're living in a very difficult time. My income is not enough. We want a house that, inshallah, you know, 20 to 30 or 25 square feet. We want a nice house, so you go get a job too. It is your responsibility. You're the man, you know. You take responsibility of her. That's her, yes, it's your responsibility to take care of her. So you should provide for her and let her sister fear Allah in her house, and that is coming bi-idhnillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, something that we're not doing it is we no longer have the ghira that is needed. There's no ghira in us, ya ikhwati fillah, nowadays. There's no jealousy. Yani you don't have that ghira, that manhood. That is subhanAllah. Now if a man looks at your sister or your wife, a brother pass by and he looks at her, what should you do? Knock him out, right? But he said, "Oh, brother, how are you? She's my sister." How did the youth? That is not acceptable. You know, you should not introduce your sister. Oh, no. Unacceptable, ya ikhwati fillah. I told you the story of when the ayah, the hukum of a man finding another man with his wife. What is the ruling initially? The ruling was, go and get four witnesses. فَقَالَ سَعَدْ بِنُ مُعَادْ Sa'ad bin Ubad, I'm sorry. And you know Sa'ad bin Ubad radiyallahu anhu. Sa'ad bin Ubad, he was the man that he got married and the family delivered the wife on a horse. And as soon as he got off the horse, what did he do? He took his dagger and he killed the horse. يَا رَجُلِ اتَّقِ اللَّهِ He said, no man would sit when my wife sat. Yani, that's how jealousy smells. No. Let him live, let the horse live. La. في سبيل الله حلال ذبيحة on the spot. No. Yani, just a thought. Oh, 5 years later, man sat at the same spot. He would not sleep with that thought. And he killed the horse. And then Allah said in the Quran, go and find 4 witnesses if you find a man with your wife. فقال سعد يا رسول الله أجل فاجر الماء You want me to find a man with my wife? I say, guys, stay where you are. I'll bring 4 witnesses inshallah. Like, just don't get anywhere. He said, Ya Rasulullah, by the time I bring the witness, they will be done. Khalas, the business is over. It's all Dalai Lama business. What do you expect? قال والله يا رسول الله والله لا أقتل I will kill them both with my sword, with the back of my sword. And he will not just kill with the the edge of his sword, no, the back, so they can die slowly. That's how he wants to kill them. So the Sahaba said, how could you talk to this? How could you say this to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi قال أتعجبون من غيرة سعد والله إني لا أغير من سعد والله أغير مني. He said, are you concerned about his jealousy? Allah is more jealous than Sa'd, and Allah is more jealous than I. A'rabi, a Bedouin, he was walking with his wife. And his wife looked at another man. And he saw that. فَقَالِ الْحَقِّ بِأَهْلِكَ Go back to your family. She said, what? It was just a look. And he said this poem to her. قال إذا وقع الذباب على الطعام رفعت يدي والنفس تشتهيه وتجنبت الأسود ورود ماء إذا كنا كلاب ولغن فيه And listen to this. He said, if a fly lands on my food while I'm eating and I still need to eat that food, I will draw my hand from the food because a fly landed on my food. يعني it's filth, خلاص. I don't want to put myself to the point that I would eat something that a fly land on it. قال إذا وقع الذباب على الطعام إذا وقع when a fly lands on the food رفعت يدي ونفسي تشتهيه يعني I still want to eat that food. I love you. يعني I still love you. But I cannot live with the thought that you looked at someone else. I cannot do this. Though I love you, I will go against my heart. قال وتجنبت الأسود ورود ماء He said, lions don't drink where the dogs drank from. And the lions don't drink from the same spot that the dogs drank from. I can't. And this is what is needed. But as we said, oh, it's okay. She's working with the man in the room. Oh, come on. Be civilized, Brother Saeed. Why are you guys being Wahhabis? Why are you guys being, come on, don't be too rigid. I trust my wife. If you tell me that I should feel jealous, that means I don't trust her. Subhanallah. What do you do with such a brother, ya ikhwati fillah? You take him for a walk, and you come back alone. Leave him there, inshallah. Because he doesn't deserve to live as a decent person. So, this is not the case for a mu'min, ya ikhwati fillah. Now, what do we need from the sisters? There are certain things that is needed from the sisters, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them, and I hope they listen to this, because again, unless we have instruction and directions to go, we cannot go anywhere. First thing that they need, they have to understand that hijab, it is not something that you desire. It is not something that you said, when I feel like it, I will. When I'm ready for hijab, I will wear hijab. When that time comes, when my iman grows, let me work on my iman first. Let me work on this, you know. Let me go to the halaqat and I be part-time hijabi. When hijab, you know, I'll wear hijab. La. You have no option here. Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu qul li azwajika wa banatika wa nisa'il mu'minin yudnina 'alayhinna min jalabibihin. Yani mas'ala, it is done deal. It's not something that we need your opinion. It is done. You don't, the brother cannot say, I don't feel like praying. Let me upgrade my iman. We don't need your opinion, and you don't need my opinion. Salah is fard, hijab is fard. No feelings involved. All the faraid, all five pillars of Islam, your feelings were, you were not even asked a question. You were told, do it. You say you're abd, you're slave, you're servant, do it. I don't want to hear your opinion in this case. Five pillars of Islam, faraid is done. So when it comes to hijab, you don't say, when I feel like it or when I'm ready. And those sisters, mashallah, who have what we call sinjab. Ta'rifuna sinjab ya ikhwa? It's a word, half of it is English and other half is Arab. Sin, ba'den jab. The bringer of sins. We call it sinjab. What does it do? They have this hijab, little hijab. I don't know where they sell these things. Probably Nike sells this, one of those stuff. But it's not hijab, but she calls it hijab. Or she wears an abaya that's so tight. All sisters, they wear abaya and they wear a tight sweater on the top of the abaya. And they look like a hot balloon. You know? Why would they do this? Allahu a'lam. La. Hijab is hijab. Allah said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the ulama agreed to this and gave the description of the hijab. Follow those instructions. Not, you know, part-time thing or call something that they call hijab, and it's not in reality hijab. The other thing, ya ikhwati fillah, that the sisters would do, including beside the hijab, is some of them, they go out with makeups or muta'attara, perfumes, and this is again unacceptable in Islam. يقول صلى الله عليه وسلم أن المرأة إذا تطيبت وخرجت من بيتها من بيت زوجها بدون إذنه لعنتها الملائكة حتى تعود. This is one of many many different narrations, different a hadith, that a woman, if she leaves the house with atr, then number one, another hadith says zaniya, another hadith says malaika curse until she comes back. So makeup and these things are not allowed in Islam. And then mashallah, sisters, they say, oh, we're not gonna put hijab, I mean in makeup and lipstick. And what do? They put, what do they call this for the lip gloss? How do you know that? I had to take that shot. Now, see, that's also, it's like the Yahud. Allah said, don't do this. They go around and do it from the other angle. Allah said, do not fish on Saturdays. So what do? They put the net on, you know. So this is unacceptable. You can't. Why would you put that thing on your lips? Unless you want, mashallah, for your lips to shine. And when you're passing by, the brother's like, ooh, mashallah. Lift the sunglasses up and look at your lips. Yeah. Unacceptable. So this is a part that the sisters have to be aware of it, bi-idhnillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. also. And this is especially for sisters who either burn oud, burn unsi, you know, all these things, this is part of it. So you cannot be in that case, and cannot be like this. Also, ya ikhwati billah, other thing that the sisters need to do is to avoid, for them to be those sisters that we're looking for, to avoid listening to music and watching, and you know, Islamic movies. You have to understand, I don't think there is a movie made by Hollywood except that it has something haram. There's no movie that is halal movie that is made by kuffar. Tell me one movie that is halal movie. Batman is haram, I'm telling you. If he was to come with the Batman, it's haram. Spider-Man is haram, you know. They have to have that scene that said, well, we have, you know, action, you know, we have a story, then we also have that part. We have to. It's part of what they sell. So music also, you just can't say, and again, some people say, oh, astaghfirullah, music is haram. But I will listen to, what is this guy? Sami Yusuf. And they said, no. He's singing about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he's playing Arabic music. I said, mashallah. Now we have a Catholic music is haram, but the Pakistani and Somali and Arab music is halal. Music is music. And Sami Yusuf, you cannot listen to him because he used music. And anyone who uses music, intimate is haram, ya ikhwati fillah. Anashid is ulama rahimahum Allah, they have fatawi about it. Someone has to show me this. This group, they came, no, not native, they're kids from Maryland. They came up with the non-Muslim songs, and they Islamized. Yani Adini would say Rawahu Bukhari, mashallah. That's the only thing that's missing. So this one of the scene, they had person who's playing Saudi Sheikh, you know, standing halal, halal, halal. And they were saying this was given by a Sheikh No, he has a what's your mama? You know, what's your imama, Sheikh? What's your something? And I could not understand. And they said, no, it means shake what your mom gave you. What are you going to shake? What are you going to shake with the imama? Yani, these things isn't halal. Well, for you to, number one, for you to be able to mimic these people, you have to listen to those songs so many times. And other scene, I can relate this one, because they were singing the song of Michael Jackson, Beat It. And he was, read the Quran. Look, well, that's disrespecting, ikhwati fillah. But this, see again, we're playing the game of Yahud. We're saying, oh, this is haram, we're not touching the haram, but we're touching the cousin of haram. Yani, it's very the same family. This is not the same, ya ikhwati fillah, and we should avoid this, especially the sisters and as well as the brothers, bi idnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the ulama rahimahum Allah said that the punishment of listening to music, ya ikhwati fillah, qala al-ghina'u barid al-zina. Al-ghina is the mailbox of a zina. And really, ghina leads you to a zina. That's what it is. And your heart can either take Quran or take the filth of these people, what they call it, music. So, ya ikhwati fillah, in a nutshell, we need a sister, a Muslimah, number one, to have iman in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inna al-mu'minina wal-mu'minat. And we also need a sister to stay at home as long there is no need for her to go out. Sister should stay home. You know, brothers, we go out because we have to work.
If the sister doesn't have to work and there's no need for her to go out, she should stay at home as much as possible, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala يقول وقرن في بيوتكن في بيوتكن ولا تبرجن تبرج الجاهلية الأولى. So يا إخوتي في الله, this is the best thing. Aisha radiallahu anha, when she was asked what is the best thing for women and what is the best thing for men, she said the best thing for women is for not to be seen by men, and the best thing for men not to be seen by women. But subhanAllah, is something that is, what can we do? Sometimes we have to go out, especially living in this country. Also, there's something that something sisters need to do, because I see brothers doing this more than the sisters, subhanAllah. And that is غط البصر. غط البصر. And the sisters who think يعني niqab is not wajib, I repeat, niqab is wajib. Based on the two strong, the strongest of the two opinions, niqab is wajib. But the sisters not wearing niqab, mashallah, we see a lot of others, they lower their gaze, but the sisters nowadays, they don't lower their gaze. And they use hadith Aisha, said, well, Aisha radiallahu anha was watching the Abyssinian playing. So it is okay for the women to look. Not when the man is standing right in front of you. Aisha radiallahu anha was hiding behind Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, and again, we discriminate. Sisters, they discriminate. They see Abu Muslima, they say, oh sister, brother, how are you? MashaAllah. But when David comes by, hey Dave, what's up? Yani as though it's haram for her to look at Abu Muslima, but it's halal for her to look at that guy. SubhanAllah, at least this Muslim man, he has haya, he has iffah, he knows that he can, but this man has none of that. So, sisters and the brothers, both we should lower our gaze, bi-idnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third and the last, ikhwati fillah, is for the sisters also to, actually before last, is for the sisters to control their tongue. And the last point I would advise the sisters to do, bi-idnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to become a da'iyat. Callers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Call people to the haqq, to the truth. And instead of talking about a ghiba and namima and backbiting this and who got married and got divorced and who got engaged and who finished school and who traveled and came back, how about if we give, the sisters start giving dawah to each other. Every building that you see, there's more than one family, Muslim family, let the sisters get together. And if they're in the halaqah, if they cannot come to the masjid, if they all can come and travel to the masjid and meet at the masjid, and they want to review something that they learn, or you know, correct their pronunciation, or sit under a sheikh or something like this, that's well, that's good. But without taking some of these steps, we may not be moving forward. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a'la wa a'lam wa jazakum Allahu khayran. For the questions, I assume that all the questions will be answered tomorrow, bi idnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. Is that the case, Hassan or Nuh? Any of them here? I think this question will be answered tomorrow, bi idnihi. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام ميم ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب ويقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون والذين يؤمنون بما أنزل إليك وما أنزل من قبلك وبالآخرة هم يوقنون
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهد الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد إخوتي في الله، فاعلموا أن خير الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, as it has been announced, we will be talking about some of the wasaya of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, some of the advice of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And these things, or these wasaya, are things that a mu'min can use his daily life. And wasiya, it could mean a command or a commandment. Allah is commanding us to do a certain thing. It also means you leaving something behind for the people to follow, such as when you leave your will behind, you left your wasiyah behind. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is commanding us in these ahadith. It is also applicable that what we are going to talk about are the things that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left behind for his ummah. It's starting from the first hadith. عن أبي الدرداء رضي الله عنه. As all of you know, يا إخوتي في الله, Abu Darda was one of the scholars of the Ummah. He was a Mufti. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr and Umar would use him to teach people. He was not a man of leadership, but he was a man of fatwa, a man that fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a person cannot reach the level of iftah unless first he sits under scholars and learns from them. So Abu Darda radiyallahu anhu sat under Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he learned so much ilm from him. One of the ilm that he conveyed or relate to the ummah is this hadith. يقول أوصاني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And listen, that Abu Darda رضي الله عنه, he's not saying أوصانا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, but he's saying أوصاني. The hadith is for the ummah. The commandment is for the ummah. The nasiha is for the ummah. However, he's using himself and he's saying أوصاني. Because if you love someone, if you really love someone, and you respect that person, and you adore that person, you would like to think that he is talking to you. So he loved Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam so much that in this hadith, that it could be that he was talking directly to him. But in this hadith, he's saying he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, advised me as Abu Darda, قال بتسعين, with 9 different advice in one hadith. And I know, between Salatul Maghrib and Salatul Isha, it is not logical or doable or have the capacity and ability to finish all the 9 wasaya. However, we will cover as many as we can be idnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. قال أوصاني بتسع لا تشرك بالله شيئا وإن قطعت أو حررت. The first of all, the first of the 9, and I will list them and then we will take them one at a time. يقول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم to Abu Darda, do not associate anyone, do not have any partners with Allah, do not worship anyone beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَإِنْ حُرِّقْ قُطِعْتْ أَوْ حُرِّقْتْ. Though the result of that iman, the result of that faith, the result of that consciousness and awareness is that the people will cut you into pieces. قُطِعْتْ. If someone kills you, he did not cut you into small pieces. If someone burns you alive, did not cut you into small pieces. But here he said, وَإِنْ قُطَعْتْ. Why? Because if someone shoots you, chops off your head, that is a peaceful way to die. But if the person cutting you into small pieces, one joint at a time, a finger at a time, removing a nail out of time, cutting an arm out of time, that is time consuming. It takes forever for you to die. It's a slow death. So in that, you may reassess the situation and you may say, let me give them what they're asking for. Let me entertain what they're requesting. So Rasulullah is saying to him, وَإِنْ قُطِعْتْ. And that is a faith in khawati fillah. This is the reality of the faith. Al-Khabbab al-Ard radiyallahu anhu, what did he say to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He comes back to Rasulullah after he's been tortured and he says, Ya Rasulullah, أَنَا تَدْعُوَ لَنَا أَنَا يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ أَلَا تَسْتَنْسِرُ لَنَا يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Are you not making dua for us? Are you not asking Allah to aid us? The kuffar are killing us. They torturing Bilal. They kill Ammar. They torturing the rest of the Sahaba. Ya Rasulullah, are you not calling Allah to aid and help us? Now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam desired, wished, wanted to teach this young man the reality of faith, the reality of iman, that it is not a lip service. It is not something that a person says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, and he walks away. La salah, la siyam, la zakah, la sadaqa, la qiyam al-layl. No. أَحَسِبَ النَّاسِ أَنْ يَقُولُ آمَنَّا وَهُمْ لَا يُفْتَنُونَ. It is not something easy for you to say لا إله إلا الله and walk away. But it is not the way of the believers. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very fair in color, light-skinned person, very shafaf, very see-through, with a beautiful face. And his cheeks used to turn red when he's upset or when he's not pleased with something. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his whole face turned red. And he sat up right under the shade of the Kaaba. And he said, the people before you who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Teaching number one, that you are not the first person, or not the first nation, not the first ummah would experience this, but he's saying there are people before you. A man will be bought, and they will bring a metal saw, and they will split his head into two halves, and this will not turn him away from his faith. Meaning, you have a salaf to follow. You have a role models to follow. You have people to follow. And it's a reminder also that if you take this path, you will succeed. You will succeed. قَالَ وَإِنْ قُتِلْتْ أَوْ حُرِّتْ قَالَ And the result could be that you will be burned alive. And then he continued with the next advice. قال ولا تتركن الصلاة المكتوبة. He said متعمدا, I never ever abandoned the 5 daily prayers. No matter what situation is, you cannot walk away from the 5 daily prayers. قال وَمَنْ تَرَكَهَا مُتَعَمِّدًا بَرِئَتْ مِنْهُ ذِمَّةُ اللَّهِ. If you willingly walk away, leave your salah, then you have no ahd, you have no covenant, you have no contract with Allah. Meaning me, you are all alone. It is your fault if something happens to you. And then he said, ولا تشربن الخمر فإنها مفتاح كل شر. And do not consume, don't drink alcohol, and anything that intoxicates you, it is underneath this. Don't do this. Why? He says, صلى الله عليه وسلم, indeed, that is the key of all evil. That is the key of all evil. قال صلى الله عليه وسلم وأطع والديك. And obey your parents. أطع means listen to them. Obey your parents. I wish the younger generation in the West understand the value of the parents. يقول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وَإِنْ أَمَرَاكَ أَنْ تَخْرُجَ مِنْ مَالِكَ مِنْ دُنْيَاكَ فَخْرُجْ مِنْهَا أَوْ فَخْرُجْ لَهُ. He said, if they ask you to walk away with everything you have, you earn, you work for, then obey them. Then obey them. قَالْ وَلَا تُنَازِعَنَّ وُلَاتِ الْأَمْرِ وَإِنْ رَأَيْتَ أَنَّكَ أَنْتْ. He said, and do not challenge the people of authority in that position. Though you may see, or you may think that you are the most suitable person for that position. You may think, oh my God, the man is not doing his job. He's not being responsible enough. Don't challenge them, because we will only create friction and fitan among the ummah. قال ولا تفر من يوم من الزحف وإن هلكت وفر أصحاب. He said, on the jihad, on the battlefield, do not walk away, do not run, do not flee, though your companions may do that, your friends may abandon you, may walk away from that, you are not doing this. قال وانفق من طولك على أهلك. He said, and spend out of your earnings, spend it on your family. Spend it on them. Don't allow anyone to take the sponsorship, the guardianship of your children, but you be a dutiful person to that person, to that responsibility. قال وأخفه في الله عز وجل وأخف أهلك and your family. Fear them, or encourage them to fear Allah. Encourage your wives, your children, not to fear you, to respect you, yes, but ask them to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first wasiyah, ikhwati fillah, that was the nine in a nutshell, concise, compressed wasiyah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, you have the detail. Yaqul, the first wasiyah, la tushrik billah, wa in qutta'at aw hurrat. Do not associate anyone with Allah, as I mentioned, if you were cut into pieces or burned alive. Why, ya ikhwati fillah? Because if you die in that situation as a mu'min, then your abode is Jannah. Your dwell, you will be among the people who will dwell in paradise. You will enjoy the price that you paid for dying for Allah. And you are shaheed, means with the first drop of blood that comes to your body, Allah forgives all the sins. Nothing between you and Allah will remain. The only thing that will remain still standing is something that you owe to your Muslim brother. Ad-Dayn, a shaheed, he will enter paradise. He will live in paradise. But the shaheed that died with Dayn, he will be at the gate outside of Jannah until that is paid off. So, a person dying in any other way is permissible, but don't die as a mushrik. يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى إن الشرك, he says shirk, polytheist, associating someone with Allah or being mushrik, polytheist being mushrik, that is a dhulm, that is the greatest dhulm. What do we mean by dhulm? Dhulm, usually, you translate that you transgressed against someone, that you did something wrong to someone. But the greatest dhulm is the one that you do to yourself. The first person who has a right on you, over you, is yourself. So when you become a mushrik, or when you associate someone with Allah, that is the worst disservice that you can do for yourself. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, inna shirka, indeed, a shirk is the greatest of all transgression, the greatest of all dhulm. In another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yaqul, وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا. Whoever associates anyone with Allah, anyone with Allah, and we do not say someone is special, no, we say anyone, including the messengers of Allah, including the salihin, including the awliya of Allah, anyone, يقول, woman يشرك, anyone who associates anyone with Allah, فقد ضل, he indeed went straight far away. You went to the extreme. You broke the record of a transgression. You crossed all the lines. You transgressed by becoming a mushrik. And another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا تَجْعَلْ مَعَ اللَّهِ. And by the way, this ayah was for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. However, it is applicable for all mankind. He said, وَلَا تَجْعَلْ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَهًا آخَرٍ فَتَبْعُدْ مَذْمُومًا مَخْذُولًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying to Muhammad, and ya ikhwati fillah, I want you, again, I always tell the brothers, when you hear the ayat of Allah, or the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abandon this worldly life that you're living in. Abandon your reality. And in a far, far away from all the distractions, from all the busyness, live in a dream. Take your soul, fly back to when ayah was revealed. Go back to Rasulullah. Imagine sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that you're looking, you're standing in front of this man, very handsome, not tall, not short, not fat, not too skinny, not wide, not narrow, not so dark, not so light. Perfect shape. A man that Allah created him to become a leader. A man that when you see him, demands your respect. Without him speaking, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, without him saying anything, you will lower your gaze. You will lower your head because you're standing in front of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even the Sahaba, who used to love him, used to be with him every single day, every single salah, they will tell you themselves, we were never able to look at the face of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hayya from Allah. Now, you are standing in front of this man sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Jibreel is talking to him, and he's saying to him, Ya Muhammad, Allah is telling you this in the Quran. وَلَا تَجْعَلْ مَعَ اللَّهِ إِلَٰهًا آخَرَ فَتَقْعُدْ مَذْمُومًا مَخْضُومًا. If you associate, Ya Muhammad, anyone with Allah, you will be forsaken. You will end up in a place which is not too pleasant. Not too pleasant. Now, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has been addressed in a very powerful manner. Very harsh. وَلَا تَجْعَلْ warning. Now, what would the condition be for Brother Saeed, who is a sinner, who has so many shortcomings? And then he decided to call upon someone else other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, in another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَقَدْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ يَا مُحَمَّدْ. It has been revealed to you, Ya Muhammad. وَإِلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ. And into those who came before you. Nuh, Adam alayhi salam, Idris, Nuh, Ibrahim, Musa, Isa, and the rest of the messages of the prophets that we don't know about them. All of them received the same message. قال لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ. If you associate anyone with Allah, anyone with Allah, now, وَاتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ خَلِيلًا. You know what Khalil? Khalil is a person. It's not that you just respect or you love. No, he is inside of your heart. Khalil is a person that is so faithful to you. You love him so much. And Allah اتخذ Ibrahim. He took Ibrahim as a Khalil. But he's telling him again to him and he's saying, لَإِنْ أَشْرَكْتَ. If you ever associate anyone with Allah, لَيَحْبَطَنَّ عَمَلُكَ. Your amal will vanish. Your salah, your ibadah, your qiyam al-layl, your jihad, your da'wah, all of that will vanish. قال وَلَا تَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. And you will be certainly, verily, surely, that person will be among the khasirin, among the losers, who lost his dunya and hereafter. قال بَلِ اللَّهَ فَاعْبُدْ. Indeed, worship Allah alone. وَكُنْ مِنَ الشَّاكِرِينَ. Now, I want you, brothers, to be honest with yourselves. How many times today, we're not talking about the whole week, How many times did you say, Ya Allah, لك الحمد والشكر. Ya Allah, I'm grateful to you that you made me your servant, not a servant of anyone else. That you made me a Muslim. How many times? Once? Twice? Even, do you really said this? Along with Allah, Ya Allah, I'm grateful to you. I'm showing gratitude and gratefulness and thankfulness that you made me a mu'min. I mean, this person, I passed by a person, and in front of their church, they have this huge Ain Salam or statues, and that is Isa alayhi salam to us. Now, they worship that. Do you worship it? You worship? No, you don't. Others, they take the urine of a cow and they wipe it over their faces and they sing, this is a blessing. This is the blessing. This is a ni'mah. A cow, they take the waste of a cow and they rub it against their faces and their bodies and they are grateful to the cow. Now, Allah didn't ask you to do this. So Allah is saying to His abd, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, بَلِلَّهَ فَعْبُدْ. Indeed, perhaps you maybe you should worship Allah and be among those who are grateful to Him. So ya ikhwa, say alhamdulillah that Allah made us Muslims. Alhamdulillah that Allah made us Muslims, made us believers that worship Allah alone. In another ayah, ikhwati fillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yaqul, innahu man yushrik billah. Indeed, whoever associates anyone with Allah, فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ. That Allah made Jannah, made paradise, haram for that person. Haram for that person. And I know, maybe in your mind, you're thinking, shirk, mushrik, means that I have to have an idol. No, it means that you rely in your heart on someone else other than Allah at the time of worship, at the time of hardship, at the time of calamity.